Welcome to Talks at GS. My name is Tony Pasquarello. I co-head U.S. Equity Sales. I'm joined today by my friend Ken Langone. Ken is the chairman and founder of Invamed Associates. He's well known for co-founding the Home Depot in 1978. Among several other board positions, Ken is the chairman of the board of trustees of NYU Langone Medical Center. Ken has lived a remarkable life, and he set a remarkable example. And he's written a whole book about it. It's called I Love Capitalism, An American Story. Ken, thanks for being here. Let's start where you do in the book, which is the very beginning. You grew up in a blue-collar family on Long Island.
Blue-collar family on the North Shore of Long Island, about 25 miles out from here, called Roslyn. I went to public schools. Dad was a plumber, went to the eighth grade. Mom went to the seventh grade and worked in a school cafeteria. I didn't realize growing up that funds were limited. I had a warm house. It didn't have air conditioning, but the house was warm in the winter and plenty of food. And it was actually an idyllic childhood, particularly because I had the parents I had and the brother that I had and the extended family. And that's very important.
So you graduated from Bucknell.
Graduated from Bucknell in February of 57, and got my formal graduation was June of 57.
You want to land a job on Wall Street, initially hard to find.
Couldn't find one.
And then you land one in the investment department of Equitable Life Insurance.
Yep.
And you're also serving in the Army.
Well, when I went to the ECK, I had to agree that I'd join the reserves. So I went in for 6 months in March of 58, and then in the summer of 61, Khrushchev built the wall around Berlin, and Kennedy needed 100,000 warriors, and I was one of the 100,000 warriors that got called back in anticipation of a troop movement to Germany if we could went to war with them. Didn't happen, and I spent 11 months at Fort Bragg, North Carolina. It was a good year.
So you're working, you're serving. You're also attending night school at NYU, I believe, a program that now bears your name.
Yep.
So what did those early years teach you about yourself and the career you wanted to have?
I always had a fixation with finance and mergers and acquisitions. And I don't know where I got it from, but I was always intrigued by it. And I used to go to the library at Bucknell. Fortune magazine used to be a much bigger publication than it is now. And I couldn't afford a subscription. They used to come out once a month. And I used to go to the library and read the Fortune magazine. And back then, it was not the nonsense they print in Fortune now, these feel-good articles about nothing. And I used to go in and read stories about corporations, and I was intrigued and fascinated. And so when I came to New York, I knew what I wanted to do. I didn't realize Wall Street wasn't ready for me. My father-in-law was with a firm called Shearson Hamel, which became part of, which is now buried someplace in J.P. Morgan. No, and Citicorp, I'm sorry. Citicorp bought Sandy Weill's business. And I've gone all over Wall Street, Goldman Sachs. You guys were at 30 Broad Street then. Whitewell, Clark Dodge, Lee Higgins, I can give you the names of all of them. I got all these interviews and it was 57, it was not a good time. We were heading into a recession. Interest rates for the moment had spiked. There was a 5%, it was a 5-year bond to the government, note of the government. It was called the Magic Fives because it was 5% for 5 years. And I ended up going to a little firm called New York and Hanseatic Corporation. They traded foreign bonds. And my father-in-law knew the fellow there, wonderful man by the name of Maurice Hart. And he said to me, look, he said, I got nothing here for you. Go out and see if you can get a job. So I went to see all these other firms and come back. Well, I couldn't get a job, and I went back to see him. And he said to me, what'd you find out? I said, I found out I can't get a job. He said, well, let me give you the secret. This is interesting. This is 60 years ago. He said, we have WASP firms for WASPs. We have Jewish firms for Jews. The Irish kids we put on the floors as clerks. And the Italian kids we put in the back office as clerks. And he said to me, you're better than that. Go out and get a job with some institution and learn the business. And he said, see if you can get more education. That's exactly what I did, and the rest is history.
It's 1974. Yep. So you've concluded a very successful run at RW Prestbridge.
Well, successful until the last 4 years. The roof fell in 1970, and I effectively, personally got wiped out. But, you know, it's lay of the land, right?
So then you set out on your own.
Set out on my own.
Invamed.
I had financed a little company in California that invented the electronic thermometer. And also, prior to this company's invention, if you went in for intravenous in the hospital, the nurse would turn a bottle upside down with a tube coming out of it. And there was a little, call it a drip chamber, and she would count the number of drops. The prescription would be in drops per minute. So they would divide it by four, and they would have drops per 15 seconds. So if they made a mistake, it was a 400% mistake. And it always was. Well, this guy had invented the first infusion pump and controller, and the infusion pump is one that actively pushes the solution into your body. The controller held it back. It only would allow so much to go through the tube every so often, so it wasn't gravity flow. And I raised $5 million for this guy in San Diego for 10% of the company. And he, third month I went out to see him, he takes me to downtown San Diego, which is not like it is now. It was all parking lots. And he says to me, you see that over there? He points to a parking lot. I said, yeah. He says, that's going to be IVAC's world headquarters. I said, shouldn't you have some sales first before you have a world headquarters? And he said to me, yeah, I guess. I knew we were in trouble. Sure enough, within 2 years, he'd blown the money. And I went and started the proxy fight. Ironically, it had never had a public offering, but he had sold stock to everybody. He'd go with his thermometer to Las Vegas. He liked to gamble, and he'd go in the back where the band was, and he'd show them the thermometer, and he'd be selling them shares for $1 a piece. And all of a sudden, he had 1,500 shareholders and never had an IPO. So I took control of the company. That was in 72. And by 74, we had it going pretty good. And that's when I decided I wanted to do something that would meld my experience and knowledge in the financial community with the healthcare field. And the name Invamed is investments in medicine now. So what did I go do? I go found a guy that likes to sell hammers and saws in Southern California, running a little company called Handy Dan Home Improvement Companies. He gets fired. I show up. I said, let's raise some money. Let's start a company. And that's Home Depot.
Bernie Marcus, Arthur Blank.
Yep.
Tell us about the birth of Home Depot, the early days.
It was tough. We had $2 million. We had a fourth guy, a very creative guy by the name of Pat Farah. And we finally opened two stores. In fact, I'll tell you a side story. The group of us gave Bernie and Arthur, they had no money at all. They were broke, no assets, nothing. Mortgages on their homes. And we gave them $2 million and said, you got a year to study America. Take your salaries, take your fringe benefits, and come back to us with a plan. If you can't do it within a year, give us what money's left, and you guys go out and get a job, and we'll lick our wounds. In November of 74, Bernie Marcus called me and said to me that J.C. Penney had announced, it was based in New York on 6th Avenue. J.C. Penney had announced they were getting out of the discount store business. They were called Treasure Island in Atlanta and Treasury in Dallas. They were big, 180,000 square foot boxes, big. And he said to me, do you know anybody at Penney? And I said, no, I was in my office. We'd raised the $2 million. And so I went over to 6th Avenue and I went upstairs and went in the real estate department, and they said, oh no, the guy that gets rid of properties on 7th Avenue, so I went around. Long story short, we made a deal, and part of the deal was that we would give them 10% of the equity, we'd give them a warrant to buy 10% of the equity if they would lease us those boxes, and we didn't want $180,000, we only wanted $60,000. So we took 60, Marshalls took 60, and I believe it was, Service Merchandise took 60. At the closing in December, a day before the closing, I said to the guy at Penny, hey, look, we've got to paper the warrants. We've got to, you know, terms and so forth. Yeah, he said, all the hell with them. He said, they're too much of a nuisance. Now, math. We've given back $110 billion to our shareholders in dividends and buybacks, and we have a $230 billion market cap today. So you figure what those warrants would be worth, a hell of a lot more than Penny is altogether today, which is not saying much.
So let's talk about culture. Home Depot is a special culture,
yep,
both as it relates to employees, mm-hmm, as well as customers. Mm-hmm. We spend a lot of time on culture at Goldman Sachs.
Uh-huh.
So whether it's Home Depot or NYU Langone or any big organization, how important is culture?
Well, here I am, NYU Langone's got PhDs, MDs, MD PhDs, brilliant people. Home Depot's got 400,000 kids for the most part, whoever, by the way, simple definition of a kid, I'm 82, if you're under 82, you're a kid, okay? The same exact thing that motivates a highly educated person is the same thing that'll motivate a poorly educated person. We all want to be respected, believe it or not. This is in our innermost thoughts. We all want to be respected. We all want to be appreciated. We all want recognition one way or the other. And we respond well to kindness. So I've always said the three most important things in the world, in my mind, is a kind word, a thoughtful gesture, and passion and enthusiasm for whatever you're doing. If you demonstrate a great love, a great passion for what you're doing, believe me, it's contagious, or the person won't stay. But so at Depot, we always had this notion that our people on the floor were as smart as we were. And in fact, we had what we call, we still have it, the inverted triangle. Most corporations are the points at the top, the CEO's there, and it works all the way down to the newest employee at the base. We take the exact opposite role. We put the people who are out there, the newly hired kids in the lot, who's the last person you see before you leave your Home Depot store, and I assume you assured me they all shop at Home Depot and not Lowe's.
Every single one.
Okay, right. And the same is true at the medical center. When I took the job at the medical center in 99, I'm not exaggerating it, it was a mess. And I was shocked to find all these highly educated, incredibly professional people that were beaten down. They were literally beaten down. And the same exact thing we did at Depot, we did with these people. So to this day, every 3 or 4 months, Bob Grossman, the dean and CEO, and I will get all the docs in a room and talk to them and say, what's on your mind? What do we need to know? What can we do better? Get it out. You know, we may agree, we may disagree, but at least you're going to have a forum to express yourself. We do the same with nurses. And it's amazing when people feel they're part of a team. They really are legitimately and truthfully part of a team. They will buy in. For the most part, they'll buy in. And every once in a while, look, I hate to sound brutal, but firing is a very important part of being a capitalist. And in the book, a couple of episodes, I tell about having to fire people, close friends. You want to destroy a business, let cronyism creep in, let favoritism creep in. You don't have that luxury. You always want to make sure you're fair and you're balanced. And most importantly at all, you recognize that each single person in that organization can make a contribution, can make a difference, can be the difference. But you got to make sure they feel comfortable about doing that. I walked into a store. We opened a store in Elmont around 1989, and Wednesday is what they call a soft opening. You just open the doors and you let people wander in. Thursday is the grand opening. You run your circulars and newspapers and grand opening, blah, blah, blah. So Tuesday night, I was over in the store. I was on Hempstead Turnpike, anybody from Long Island, by the racetrack. And a kid comes up to me who I knew, and he says to me, "Can I ask you a question?" I said, "Sure." He said, "Were you guys born stupid or did you become stupid?" And I said, "One thing about kids, subtlety is not one of their strong suits. We learn that in life. We get that trait later on." I said, "Maybe one or the other, but probably both." He said, "Come on, I want to show you something." He takes me over to the plumbing department. And we had plungers. Now, think about a plunger. You don't wake up on Saturday morning and say to your wife, "Hey, honey, let's go to Home Depot and buy a plunger." Right? When do you buy a plunger? When you need it at 3 o'clock in the morning. Your wife's telling you that the toilet stopped up or something's wrong, and you haven't got a plunger, and you first thing you do is get up in the morning and run down to Home Depot and buy a plunger. It's an emergency type purchase. It isn't something you typically will buy as part of a shopping list. So he shows me where it is. It's way down below at the base. And he says to me, "It's dirty in there." And I said, "Well, all right, so what would you do?" He says, "Well, I'd put pipe hangers up and down the rack, at the end of the rack, the end cap. And I'd have the hangers like you go to a gun store, how they show guns." He said, "I'd have the hangers," because I said, "Okay." I said, "Why don't you do it?" And he said to me, "Well, can I do it?" I said, "Why can't you do it?" He said, "Well, how will people feel?" I said, "Well, why don't you give it a try?" I said, "You know, maybe it's the best idea you ever had, maybe it's the worst idea." I said, "If it doesn't work, take the pipe hooks down, put the plungers back in the box, and let people get dirty when they buy them again. No loss." So Saturday morning, about 11 o'clock, I'm in the store. It's the first weekend of the opening of the store. And I go through the plumbing department, and the kid runs at me and says to me, "Guess what? Guess what? We're out of plungers." "Hey, honey, we haven't got a plunger. We better pick one up, $3 or $4 a piece." There's capabilities inside of each and every one of us. Every single one of us can make a contribution. And if you go aspire to be a manager, then you got to figure a way out to motivate those people. First of all, that a mistake, an honest, legitimate mistake, is not a career killer. But there's certain things you do, no matter what you do, you're gone. Ethics, values, and so forth. But the second thing is you want to have an environment where the best minds are found out. When we opened our first two stores, we had enough money for merchandise at the eye level of the customer. Now, we had these racks. If you go to Home Depot, they're 20 feet high. 2 weeks before the opening, these two stores in Atlanta, we realized we got no merchandise and we got no money. Pat Farah gets an idea. He calls up all the manufacturers who wouldn't give us any more than what we had. They were worried about getting dinged. And Pat Farah said to them, "Okay, you won't sell us merchandise. How about giving us empty boxes with your labels on them?" So when you walked in these two stores, oh my God, look at the merchandise in this store. Holy, it was all air. There was nothing in the boxes. Not a thing. But it made the statement, "We got everything, we got it in depth, and whatever you want." And that was the image we were, you gotta be a little creative.
So, I Love Capitalism, American Story. Thank you, this has been fantastic.
Thank you all for having me.